As we go to air tonight, there are reports of multiple explosions in the cities of Kyiv and Kharkiv after Vladimir Putin authorised the invasion of Ukraine. The Russian president issued the order as the UN Security Council called on him to back down. Putin also warned the West to stay out of his way or face consequences that they've never experienced in their history.
We will strive for the demilitarization and denazification of Ukraine, and will bring to justice those who committed multiple bloody crimes against civilians, including Russian civilians.
In response, Ukraine's President Volodymyr Zelensky has declared martial law, urging citizens to remain calm.
Do not panic. We are strong. We are ready for anything. We will beat anyone because we are Ukrainians. Glory to Ukraine.
US President Joe Biden has branded the invasion unprovoked and unjustified. Here at home, Scott Morrison also condemned the invasion, calling on Russia to withdraw or face even further sanctions.
We must ensure there is a cost for this violent, unacceptable and egregious behaviour. There must be a cost.
Here is how a dramatic day unfolded.
The Ukrainians are facing another aggression just because they dare to exist, because they have chosen to be independent, because they have opted for democracy.
It is coercion, it is bullying by an authoritarian power against a democratic neighbour.
That's why I want to address today the people of Russia. I am addressing you not as a president, I am addressing you as a citizen of Ukraine.
In the name of humanity, do not allow to start in Europe what could be the worst war since the beginning of the century.
Return to your borders. Send your troops and your tanks and your planes back to their barracks and hangars.
Today, I initiated a phone call with the President of the Russian Federation. The result was silence.
The world is calling for peace, but Russia is not listening.
Breaking news at 11, a Russian invasion of Ukraine is underway as troops move in.
I decided to conduct a special military operation. Its goal is the protection of people who, during 8 years, suffer from abuse and genocide from the Kyiv regime.
Right now, there are reports of explosions in several cities.
I think it's relatively safe at the moment. Look, I've got a...
Hearing a lot of outgoing artillery fire.
Cruise and ballistic missile strikes are underway. People here are terrified.
I am confident that loyal soldiers and officers of Russia's armed forces fulfill their duty professionally and courageously.
There is no purgatory for war criminals. They go straight to hell.
Hands off Ukraine! Hands off Ukraine! Hands off Ukraine! Hands off Ukraine!
Josh Manning is a former Russian analyst for the US military and joins us now. Ukraine's only just calling up its military reservists now, Josh. Meanwhile, Russia has around 200,000 troops. What chance has Ukraine got, do you think?
I think Ukraine has a morality and a spirit and esprit de corps that Russia doesn't have. The Russian troops that they're sending in, right, they send in troops from Siberia, which is a backwater. And so, you know, that's thousands of miles away. They shipped them into the West. And I'm not going to say that they're using it as a road bump, but right, they're just throwing troops at this to try and put as many people at this as possible. Whereas the Ukrainians have a real spirit and they're really fighting for a future that a lot of us aspire that they reach. And so my hope is that they fight hard and that they can overcome what is going to be an onslaught of just it's brutal proportions, right? This is the Wehrmacht, right? This is going back to Hitler's Germany. They're going to come in with power and shock and awe that the world hasn't seen in a long time. And I think Russia wants to showcase that.
So, Josh, I mean, the stakes are extremely high the way that you frame them. And yet, is anyone going to do anything ultimately about this? I mean, Western nations have said that they won't contribute troops, if Russia just says, we're going to do this, what is anyone willing, not just able, but willing to do?
I think people need to think larger than that. I think people need to look at... I think Ukraine will emerge okay from this. That's what I'm trying to say. And I think what'll happen is that you're talking about the Germans, you know, you're talking about power and you're talking about all sorts of things that are going to happen in Eastern and Western Europe. And there's a grander game to this that is being fought out, and that will be fought out with sanctions, will be fought out with what we call strategic deterrence, right? Sending troops to the Baltics, sending troops to Poland, sending troops to Romania, to really keep this nipped in the bud to Ukraine. And as bad as it is for the Ukrainians, and as much as I think the Ukrainians will succeed, it's going to be tough to watch. But I think in the end, I think we emerge in a stronger place. And I think the Putin regime, overconfident and overextended, emerges in a much lesser place from all of this. And I think that's the larger goal that people are trying to hold on to here.
Can you explain how that would work? Because from this distance, it just looks like David versus Goliath. Sorry, that's a bad example because David won, didn't he? But you know what I mean. I mean, they're outgunned. The Ukraine is outgunned. And if they're not going to find on-the-ground military assistance, why is it that Russia will end up in a situation where they're overextended or where Ukraine somehow triumphs and becomes better at the end of this?
You know, this sounds idealistic of me, and I'm not very idealistic, but... the unity of the West and all of this to watch Germany and France, to watch them lead, right? Like, it wasn't like we forced them to cancel Nord Stream 2. Germany did that on its own after a long struggle to not do so. France has come in and said, we tried diplomacy. It didn't work out, guys. You know, we're with you now. A lot of this is Putin being too overconfident and people thinking that he wasn't going to do this. And then he did. And so I think this is going to cancel out a lot of people who had his support. And I think you can build from those cracks and start to really fill them out and erode what, you know, it's a horrible authoritarian regime in Moscow that needs to go away. This isn't in the interest of the Russian people.
Josh, we really appreciate you sharing your insights. Thanks for joining us.
Thank you so much.
Taras Sementuk is a journalist in Kyiv whose family is preparing right now to flee, and he joins us now. Taras, have there been any explosions where you are?
Yeah, I woke up this morning hearing explosions. And I saw the first video that Putin launched his attack. And after that, I go out from my house. And I hear another voices of attack near Kyiv. And for me, it was like, whoa, what's this? What does it mean? Because it was unexpected for us. And after that, I read that ballistic rocket targeted the main military centers near Kyiv, Borispol International Airport, the center of managing flights. And after that, I saw the map there. The same ballistic rockets targeted all cities in Ukraine, also in the west part of Ukraine, Ivano-Frankivsk, Khmelnytsk, and Lutsk. Why these cities? Because there is the main strategic centers of aviation navy. The capital is, I saw no panic. The people in tranquility goes to shelters with children, with bags. So no panic, but a lot of people escaping from the capital. We have a lot of traffic outside the Kyiv, for example, in the road to the Lviv, to the west part, the Zhytomyr. This is the morning for Ukraine now, and it's a pity, it's a sad that for the first day in my life, and my son with 6 years hear it for the first life, the sirena, and for the first time he left the school.
How are the people of Ukraine holding up right now, and how are you holding up?
I feel good. Managing my family to stay now in Kyiv because it's impossible to go out from the city. We are waiting for the next few hours. What will happen? And if I will have possibility, I will send my family by car to the safety city, but I will stay in Kyiv. It's very important to know that Putin invaded all Ukraine, not Donbas, but all Ukraine. And the whole world should know that Putin is a killer. Putin is a murderer, and Putin is wants to control all Ukraine. And I think Ukraine will not be the last stop for the Putin. The next could be Poland and other countries.
Well, the defiance of the Ukrainian people certainly is coming through loud and clear, Taras. Thank you so much for your time tonight. Please do stay safe.
Let's keep in touch. Let's keep in touch.
Alla Koshlyak is a host at Radio NV in Kyiv, and she joins us now. Alla, we've seen footage of explosions in Kyiv. What have you witnessed?
I woke up today at, I think, something around 5 in the morning. My friend called me. She lives nearby the airport, and she heard the explosions. And now people are told to stay at home or go to the some places to hide from the bombs. And the public transport now is free of charge, and everybody is allowed to go there. Also, a lot of people are trying to get cash from the ATMs and gas from the gas stations. So everything is still working. I mean, public transport, railways, airports are closed now, for now. And as we know, the explosions were near the airports. So that's all I can say you for now, I think.
Alla, we're seeing queues of people trying to leave, but you're still there, you're still reporting. Are you scared at the moment?
No, I'm just doing my job. And my decision from the first day of the war actually was that I'm not leaving Ukraine anyway and anywhere. I was saying about people with like elderly, small children, people who cannot join the territory defense, who is not in the army, who is not the journalist. Also, we have the map of the safe places where you can hide if the bombing starts. So we have some kind of plan B.
Are they bomb shelters? What sort of places are being provided for locals to hide?
Yes, shelters, and also we can use our metro underground. Yeah, it is quite huge in Kyiv and quite deep underground.
Alla, the defiance of the Ukraine people is well and truly on display. We're seeing pictures of grandparents taking up arms and preparing to fight. How confident are you in Ukraine's ability to fight off the Russians?
I'm sure that Russians couldn't win this nation. I know it sounds kind of very... maybe not normal in this situation, but yeah, really, people who are 18 and people who are 80 are joining the territory defense forces. So not a lot of people are trying to move as far as possible. Many people are staying here.
Alla, our thoughts are with you. Stay safe. Thank you so much for your time tonight.
Thank you.
Well, let's head to Moscow now, where James Beardsworth is waiting for us. He's a reporter for the Moscow Times. James, Russia and Ukraine have woken up to the news that Putin has effectively ordered an invasion of Ukraine. The world has been warned many times that this was going to happen, but when it does finally happen, is it still a shock?
Yeah, it's a massive shock. I think the feeling amongst Russians, certainly for the last 2 weeks, has been that Putin's kind of deploying an aggressive sort of diplomacy. He's trying to sort of sound the sirens for war to make the different countries come to the negotiation table and then getting that seal of approval that Ukraine won't be allowed to join NATO. Waking up to the news this morning, it's shocking. When, like, what Putin's plans are, we initially thought that perhaps he wanted to move into that eastern part of Ukraine to take the Donbas region. We're seeing reports that actually Russian troops are moving over the sort of more northeastern border of Ukraine, as well as from Belarus as well. And we're also hearing reports of explosions from sort of major cities in the east of Ukraine.
How do the Russian people feel about this? Are they privately behind Putin?
No, absolutely not. And that's the interesting thing. What makes this particularly shocking is the fact that in 2014, when we saw the annexation of Crimea, that came with huge boost to Putin's popularity back home. The Russian people thought that the sort of ethnic Russians that were in Crimea at the time, their rights weren't being respected by the current Ukrainian government. This is something that is not the case in this escalation. Russians that I've spoken to certainly don't want war. I was out on the streets of Moscow last week. If I can actually just read to you a couple of things that some Muscovites said to me. One 19-year-old Lisa said, I think we shouldn't get ourselves into a conflict. We need peace. We don't need a war or a hostile relations with anyone. Another one of the interviewees said to me, Putin is very smart. He wouldn't allow war, especially not between Ukrainians and Russians. We are one people with almost the same language. Why would we fight our brothers? So that just gives you an idea of the sort of shock this morning, waking up to the news.
So how far do you think Putin will be prepared to go, James?
That's a very good question. The president has outlined today that he doesn't intend a military occupation. How far he will go is anyone's guess. I don't pretend to know what goes on inside the head of the Russian president. I think so far what's happened is a shock. Whether he will sort of hold his military forces and then sort of use this initial attack as a way in which he can get that approval from NATO that Ukraine won't be allowed to join the alliance is something that's on the table still, but it's looking increasingly unlikely.
Putin's address announcing the special military operation appears to have been pre-recorded. What does that tell us?
Well, this whole thing has been sort of run a little bit like a circus. On Monday, I think it was, there was a Security Council meeting where there was a discussion taken about whether Russia should recognise the Donbass as independent republics. We saw that aired live on TV as an alleged live address. It turned out actually it wasn't a live address. So it would seem that this whole thing has been scripted for a while. Remember that the sort of build-up on the Ukrainian border has been going on for nearly 4 months now, since November last year. As well as the fact we've also seen southern airports in Russia closed until the 3rd of March is the information we're getting this morning. So whether that's any sort of telltale sign about what the Kremlin has planned over the next 2 weeks is potentially another thing to look out for.
Really interesting to hear from Ukrainian President Volodymyr Zelensky, who gave a speech in Russian overnight, making an emotional plea, especially to Russian citizens, and telling them that they are being misled on the war and on what's happening in Ukraine. Are the Russian people getting the truth on the conflict, do you think?
Not wholly, absolutely not. We're seeing sort of media reports come out of the Donbass region that Russia recognises as two independent republics this week, saying that there's shelling being taken out by the Ukrainian forces. That is certainly not the case. It would seem that the aggressor here is certainly on the side of Russia and the militias in the Donbass. So, no, there will be a spin, I would imagine, being put on it by the Kremlin in the next few days to try to sort of stir up this agenda that Ukraine is on the offensive. Now, we've seen in Zelensky's speech, he says, we will defend our nation. We will not attack, we will defend our nation.
And do you think that Russians, just ordinary Russians, feel sympathy for Ukrainians who are right now fleeing or fighting off attacks?
Absolutely. Absolutely. It's very clear that the Russians don't want war. First and foremost, we've seen, as a result of the pandemic and the last few years, a stagnation set in the Russian economy. I was speaking to a friend the other day who said, why would we have war when there's not even a nicely paved road to my parents' house? Russians don't want war. There will be media reports that we'll see come out over the next few days saying, why aren't we seeing Russians on the street? Where is this rejection? Russians want this war. I would really push back on that. I would say that is not the case. There has been protests we've seen, but in very, very, very small amounts, because, of course, the certain laws in Russia require you to get a sanction to go out into the streets and protest. They won't be sanctioned. It will mean that any sort of protestations against this will be quickly cracked down on.
James, so good to get your thoughts tonight. Thanks so much for your time.